Hello everyone, welcome to Reactify Labs. Today we will talk about something called message broker. So I have made a separate video on message queue in which I have talked in detail about message queues. In this video, we are going to talk about message broker and a little bit about message queues as well, so that we can know what's the difference between a message broker and a message queue. Okay. So let's start by seeing why do we need a message broker? What is it that could not be solved without the message broker? Okay. And also without the message queue. Okay. And what could not be solved by message queue that we need message broker as well? Okay. So it's not like an enhancement or something. It's just that the way systems work, we needed a message broker because only the message queues did not suffice. Okay. So let's take a real world example. So you are using Amazon for shopping. Okay. Amazon shopping app. Okay. So what you are doing is you went to the website or you opened the app. Okay. That's fine. You browsed. That's fine. Then what you did, you placed the order, let's say. You placed the order. Okay. So what happened here? As soon as you placed the order, let's say you did the payment. Okay. From your end, you completed payment. Okay. Then what happens? So at that time, what happens is, a few things get generated. One is your order confirmation. Okay. Next is your payment receipt. Payment receipt. Okay. Now, is there anything else? For the sake of simplicity, let's assume that there are only two things. Okay. Now, basically, you know, Amazon is such a big company, big application. They have different microservices, right? So we have an order microservice, let's say, which knows, okay, this order you have placed, so it needs to take care of some things. It may have a payment microservice, which will tell it, okay, the payment has been done. Okay. So what happens? This order confirmation receipt or ID will go to the order microservice. This payment receipt will go to this payment microservice, right? Okay, that's fine. Now what? What's the issue here? You can anyway send it, right? That's fine. But the problem is, along with you, 1 million other users also did the same thing. Also did the same thing, right? So everybody placed the order. So basically, since you were not the only one, it's not that your thing will be processed first, or only your order confirmation and payment receipt will be processed, right? And since there are 1 million users along with you, it's not that they have 1 million other microservices, 1 million other microservices to handle this, 1 million other order microservice and 1 million other payment microservice to handle this, right? It's also not the case. So what happens? What should it do? So it needs to go through an intermediary, basically. So which will just take it and do the processing asynchronously. Okay. And that intermediary is called a message broker. So you can ask, but that was a message queue. Why cannot we use message queue? Why need a message broker? Yes. Good question. So let's go into the theory and see why we need a message broker. Okay. Let me explain it. While talking through the theory, and while talking also I'll keep giving examples, okay, and some real life use cases also. Okay, just in short, let's assume or understand that this message for sending this order confirmation receipt to this order microservice, we have one message queue. For payment, we have another message queue, and A message broker is just a collection of these message queues. Okay, so this is in short. Then let's see what is in not short or what is in long. What's the real deal? So we will start with the definition of message brokers. Message brokers. What are message brokers? Or what is a message broker basically? What is a message broker? A message broker is a sophisticated piece of middleware basically. It's a middleware. Okay? Just like a broker. Broker is also a middleware, right? Anywhere if you go in life, let's say you are house hunting. So it's you, it's your house. There will be a middleman which will help you find your house, right? Even when you do, let's say, trading in stock markets. So this is you. This is the stock market. Let's say, what is that? Either NYSE or BSE, right? And here is your broker. This is a broker like Fidelity or Robinhood. These are brokers. So everywhere there is a broker because NYSE cannot serve all the requests by itself. It does not have that technical capacity, technological capacity to serve millions of requests or billions of requests, right? So there is a broker, right? Which makes it sophisticated. You just tell the broker, broker will deal with NYSE. So NYSE will also tell the broker, broker will deal with you. So this is what happens. Decoupling happens here. So everywhere in life, we have a broker, right? So that's what the role of a broker is. If you relate it with real life scenario, that yes, in real life, this is a broker. So in systems also, this, that is a broker. If you see, computer science field is hardly 50, 60 years old, right? So every term that it has, it more or less it exists from some of our real world examples or real world or real life, right? So if you think something sounds similar, like, okay, in real world, this means this, then there are high chances that in computer world, this means the same thing, okay? So the broker in computer science is not different, or the broker in system design is not different from what you know in real life, okay? Now let's go back to our definition. So a message broker is a middleware that sits between the services. That sits between the services in our system. That sits between the services in our system. Its primary role is to facilitate communication. Okay. Its primary role is to facilitate communication by receiving messages from producers. Producers means the one who is producing the message. Okay. In that case, that was the order confirmation generator. Okay. By receiving messages from producers, performing various operations. Performing various operations on them. Like routing, transformation, filtering. Routing, transformation, filtering, etc., and then delivering them to appropriate consumers. And then delivering them to appropriate consumers. Okay. So in real world analogy, let's think of it like this. Other than this, the broker example that I gave you for stock broking and house hunting, another very sophisticated example would be air traffic control. So planes, think of planes as messages. Okay. They come in from different locations. Means these planes, what does a plane look like? I don't know. So let's say this is a plane. These planes come from different locations. Let's say some plane comes from Australia, some comes from Delhi, some comes from San Francisco, some comes from New York, right? There are multiple planes. So consider these planes as messages, okay? And these, the locations from where these planes are coming, consider them as producers, okay? So planes come from different locations. And the tower, the ATC, air traffic control tower. This is the ATC. So this tower is a broker, okay, this tower is a broker, and this tower directs the planes to appropriate runway, and this runway, this is the runway, right? So let's say there are multiple runways. So this runway, the planes, this ATC will direct them to these runways, right? And this runway is the consumer. So which runway will get which plane is like which consumer gets which message, right? So the tower might also change plane's flight path to ensure that it reaches its destination safely. It means it can tell the plane also that, okay, see, you cannot come here actually, or you cannot land here. You have to go somewhere else due to many reasons, right? So basically that is transforming the message, right? And transforming also means that, okay, maybe you cannot land from this side. Maybe you have to land from this side, right? Or maybe you were supposed to land here, but don't do it. Actually, before landing, you have to do some things like take some time in the air because the runway is not empty. So basically these are all like transforming the message. So we all, if you see in this example, we saw everything. We have the message, we have the producer, we have the consumer, we have the broker, right? Message was the plane. Producer was the location from which the planes were originating. Consumer was the runway where those planes will land. And broker is the our ATC controller. And transformation of message is just processing in the middle. Okay. So these all are covered in this example. Okay. And technically, if you see, so imagine you have an online shopping platform. The order service sends an order confirmation message and the payment service sends a payment receipt, right? The one which I gave in the beginning. The message broker can route the order confirmation to the customer notification service and the payment receipt to the billing service, ensuring each message reaches the destination correctly. Because once your order is confirmed, you will get the notification, right? And the payment service will get, okay, the payment has been successful. So now the order processing should start. So that's why different messages should go to different places basically. One will go to notification service, one will go to the payment service, okay? Now let's see how message brokers work. How message brokers work. So first step is message reception. Okay. When a producer sends a message, the message broker first receives it and stores it temporarily. This ensures that the message won't be lost even if the consumer isn't immediately ready to process it. Next step would be message transformation. So one of the key features of a message broker is the ability to transform messages. For example, a broker might convert a message from one format like XML to another format like JSON to ensure that receiving service can understand it. Okay. Next is message routing. Message brokers are incredibly powerful when it comes to message routing. They can route messages based on their content, their headers, or specific rules defined in advance. For example, messages containing order might be routed to order management service, while those containing payment might be sent to the billing service, right? And next is message delivery. Finally, the broker delivers the message to the appropriate consumer. This delivery can be done in various ways, such as pushing the message directly to the consumer or allowing the consumer to pull the messages when it's ready, right? So push mechanism and pull mechanism. I have talked about this in the CDN topic. If you have not watched that video, please go and watch that. I think I have talked about it. If not, please let me know in comments. I will make another video on push and pull mechanism. Okay, now let's see the types of message brokers. So first one is traditional message brokers. So traditional message brokers like RabbitMQ and ActiveMQ are designed for scenarios where you need reliable message delivery and advanced routing. They handle message queuing, routing, and transformation all within a single system. For example, RabbitMQ can take messages from an inventory service, transform them into a standardized format, and route them to various services like shipping, notification, and billing. Okay. Next is event streaming platforms. Event streaming platforms. Platforms like Apache Kafka serve as both message brokers and event streaming platforms. Kafka is optimized for high throughput, low latency message handling, making it ideal for real-time data processing and event-driven architectures. Apache Kafka can be used to process real-time data streams like tracking user activity on a website. Each activity, like clicks, searches, is treated as an event and sent to different services for analysis, recommendation, and logging. Just like when you use Instagram. So the amount of time you spend watching on a reel, if you have watched it multiple times, if you have shared it, all those things are taken care while deciding the recommendation. Okay. Now let's talk about the features. Features of message broker. Features of message broker. So first is load balancing. Yes, other than message routing, what else it can do? Okay, so basically advanced features. So load balancing. Message brokers can distribute messages across multiple consumers to balance the load, ensuring no single service is overrun. This is especially important in systems where traffic can spike unexpectedly. Second is message acknowledgement. To ensure reliability, message brokers often use acknowledgement mechanisms. Consumers must confirm that they have successfully processed a message, which prevents message loss and ensures all messages are eventually handled. Okay. Next is dead letter queues. Dead letter queues. So if a message can't be delivered or processed after several attempts, it might be placed in a dead letter queue. This allows us to investigate and handle problematic messages separately. Okay. So basically, if you don't know what dead letter queue is, so basically, if let's say for a particular message, retry is like retrying the message for 5 times. And if after 5 times also the message is undelivered, it's sent to another queue, which is separate from these message queues, which is called DLQ, dead letter queue. The messages are stored here. And when the developers or anyone responsible for this, they come, they can come and manually check it. That, okay, what's the problem with this? Why it could not be delivered? Maybe the header was wrong, it was tampered, or something was the problem with the body or subrouting mechanism. So they can take it, they can manually observe it, and they can correct it, and then send it back to queue, back to our message queue, okay? And then it will be sent. So dead letter queue is basically a temporary place where failed messages are stored so that it does not clutter the original message queue with failed messages. Okay, so this was all about dead letter queues. Okay, next let's see the advantages of message brokers. Advantages. So complex routing and transformation. Complex routing and transformation. Message brokers excel at handling complex routing scenarios and transforming messages between different formats. This makes them invaluable in systems where services are diverse and communicate using different protocols. Second is flexibility and extensibility. Flexibility and extensibility. Because message brokers are highly configurable, they can be tailored to fit a wide range of use cases, from simple point-to-point messaging to sophisticated publish-subscribe platforms. And decoupling of systems. Decoupling of systems. Message brokers decouple producers and consumers, allowing them to evolve independently. This is crucial in large-scale systems where different teams might be responsible for different services. The best example of decoupling is, let's say, again, this is you, this is NYSE, New York Stock Exchange. And let's say tomorrow, some 10 new stocks get added to them. So New York Stock Exchange does not need to inform you of this, right? It does not deal with you. So there is a broker here. So this broker will take care of these, how to handle these new stocks that are added, and you can just talk to the broker. So basically it decoupled. It does not have, New York Stock Exchange does not have any dependency on you. You don't have any dependency on this. You don't need to worry about how will you trade in the newly added stocks. So it's all the job of the broker. So basically if you see this job decoupled, so, and this job, this broker, this does not specialize in how to onboard these stocks to NYSE. This specializes in how to just connect you to the new stocks, right? How to add those new stocks to its system. This adding this new stocks to the NYSE also was a very complicated process, and NYSE is specialized in handling those kinds of scenarios. Okay, but how it will reach you is something which broker should be responsible. Okay, so that's how broker makes sure that this the decoupling in the system is ensured. Okay, so but what are the challenges? Because every sophisticated system comes with its own challenges. So the first challenge is setup and maintenance complexity. Setup and maintenance complexity. Deploying and managing a message broker can be complex, especially in large systems. Configuration, monitoring, and scaling requires expertise and careful planning. Okay? And potential performance overhead. Potential performance overhead. The additional features of message brokers like message transformation and complex routing can introduce some performance overhead. This might lead to increased latency, particularly in high throughput systems. Obviously, because now this message needs to go through this message broker to the destination. Obviously, some latency will be introduced, some performance overhead will be there. But if you see, if this comes at the cost of a decoupled system, which in turn is making a lot of other tasks easier or free of issues, or like none of these people need to worry about how to handle those things. So basically it's worth the trade-off. A latency of a few milliseconds is worth the trade-off. Okay, great. Now use cases. So we have discussed a lot of use cases. Let's talk about it once more. So enterprise service bus architectures, okay, ESB, architectures. So message queues are often used as the backbone of ESB architectures, where they mediate communication between numerous enterprise applications, each with its own protocol and data format, okay, and microservices communication. Microservices communication. In microservices architectures, message brokers enable asynchronous communication between services, improving system resilience and scalability. Okay, now let's talk a little bit about message queues. Since we have already made a separate video on message queues, I'm not going to talk about them in detail, but just a high level overview. So a message queue is a simpler component compared to message broker. It's a linear data structure where messages are stored in a sequence and processed in the order they arrive, usually FIFO, first in, first out. Message queues are primarily focused on reliably delivering messages from producers to consumers. So think of message queues like a checkout line at a grocery store. Customers are considered as messages, join the line. The cashier is the consumer, which processes them one by one. The first consumer in the line is served first. Consider a task queue in web application where users upload images for processing. The images are queued up and the workers process them one by one, ensuring no images missed. And how message queues work? So again, first step is message enqueuing. Producers send messages to the queue where they are stored temporarily until a consumer is ready to process them. The queue ensures that messages are delivered in the exact order they were sent. Then message dequeuing happens. Consumers retrieve messages from the queue in the same order they were enqueued. This orderly processing is ideal for tasks that must be handled sequentially, such as processing orders or executing jobs. And concurrency management. To handle high volumes of messages, multiple consumers can be attached to the same queue, processing messages in parallel. This allows the system to scale horizontally, distributing the load across several services. Like let's say this is the message queue and there is one consumer. Okay, one message goes to this consumer, and once this message gets processed, only then the next message will go, right? But if we can horizontally scale it like this, if we have multiple consumers, then multiple messages, like this message will go here, next message will go here, next message will go here. So parallel processing will happen for the messages, right? So that's what it was in the concurrency management. If we talk about the features of message queues, these are delayed messaging, retry mechanisms, and dead letter queues. Advantages is the simplicity. It's more simple than message broker. Message queues are simple to implement and manage, making them an attractive option for basic asynchronous communication. They provide just enough functionality without the complexity of a full-fledged broker. Message queues are highly reliable, ensuring that messages are not lost even if the consumer crashes or is temporarily unavailable. With support for multiple consumers, message queues can distribute processing tasks effectively, balancing the load across available resources. Message queues also have some challenges like limited routing capabilities. Unlike message brokers, message queues typically deliver messages in strict FIFO order. Without advanced routing or transformation capabilities, this can be a limitation in more complex systems. And while message queues can scale horizontally by adding more consumers, they may struggle in environments where complex routing, filtering, or message transformation is required. And if you talk about the use cases, first is background job processing. Like message queues are often used to handle background tasks like sending emails, processing images, or generating reports. These tasks can be enqueued and processed asynchronously, freeing up resources for more immediate tasks and load balancing. In systems where you need to distribute work evenly across multiple services, message queues provide a simple and effective way to manage load. For example, web servers might enqueue requests for backend processing, allowing multiple workers to handle them concurrently. Okay. Now that we have talked about message broker as well as message queues, let's see what are the differences between message queue and message broker. So message broker versus message queue. Okay. So first one is, let's say, functional comparison. So in message brokers, we have message brokers and message queues. Okay, let's talk about message brokers first. So message brokers offer a wide range of features beyond simple message delivery, including protocol translation, complex routing, message filtering, and transformation. They act as intelligent intermediaries in distributed systems. So a message broker can manage multiple message queues, each serving different purpose within the system. As I said in the beginning, message broker is more complex than message queue. Okay. And one message broker can have multiple message queues. Okay. So this is very important. This is a fundamental difference. A complex routing and also a message broker can be a collection of message queues. Okay. So a message broker can manage multiple message queues, each serving different purpose within the system. For example, one queue might handle user registration events, while another handles order processing. This allows the broker to efficiently organize and manage different types of messages, ensuring that each type is processed by the appropriate service. For example, imagine an e-commerce platform where the message broker has separate queues for inventory updates, payment processing, and shipping notifications. Each queue is handled by a different microservice, ensuring that these processes run independently but cohesively. If we talk about message queues, so message queues focus on reliable, ordered message delivery with minimal additional features. They are simpler to set up and manage, making them suitable for straightforward use cases. A message queue typically handles one type of task or message sequence. This simplicity is beneficial in scenarios where tasks need to be processed in the exact order they arrive, such as processing transactions or executing jobs in a specific sequence. Consider a payroll system where each payroll task must be executed in the correct order. A single message queue would ensure that all payroll processing steps are followed in sequence with no risk of tasks being handled out of order. Okay. Next, architectural impact. So architecture wise, what's the difference between message broker and message queue? Okay. So in systems where services are loosely coupled and need to interact in complex ways, Message brokers provide the necessary flexibility and control. They can mediate between services that use different protocols and data formats. The ability to manage multiple queues under one broker allows for centralized control while supporting a distributed architecture. Each queue can be dedicated to a specific microservice or function, making the system more modular and easier to scale. In a travel booking system, the broker might have queues for flight bookings, hotel reservations, and car rentals, each handled by separate services. This organization enables the system to process and coordinate these related tasks efficiently, despite them being handled by different services. Okay? And for message queue, for systems where the primary concern is ensuring that tasks are processed in the order they are received, message queues are an ideal choice. They introduce less overhead and complexity, making them easier to scale. With a focus on specific tasks, message queues are ideal for scenarios where you need to ensure that each task is handled individually and in the correct sequence, such as processing bank transactions or order fulfillment. A financial application might use a dedicated queue to ensure that each transaction is processed in the exact order it was received, guaranteeing consistency and accuracy in the transaction records. Okay. Next, scalability and performance. Scalability and performance. Message brokers can handle very high throughput, especially when used in event-driven architectures. However, their complexity can introduce latency, particularly when messages need to be transformed or routed through complex logic. The ability to manage multiple queues allows a message broker to scale efficiently by distributing workloads across various queues. Each queue can be scaled independently depending on the traffic it receives. In a large-scale online marketplace, the broker might have a high-volume queue for order placement and a lower-volume queue for customer service inquiries. Each queue can be scaled according to demand, ensuring optimal performance. But for message queues, so these were for message brokers. But for message queues are designed for high performance in scenarios where the order of message processing is critical. They can scale horizontally by adding more consumers, though they might require additional components to handle more complex scenarios. Message queues scale by adding more consumers to handle the increased load. This simplicity is effective in environments where tasks are homogeneous and can be processed in parallel. A video processing service might use a message queue to manage video encoding tasks. As demand increases, more processing nodes can be added to consume messages from the queue, allowing the system to scale easily. Okay. Now let's see when to use what. When to use message broker. So we can use message broker when we need advanced features like content-based routing, protocol translation, or message filtering. Our system requires interaction between diverse services with different data formats or communication protocols. We are implementing an event-driven architecture where services need to subscribe to specific event streams. So if our system handles various types of messages that need to be processed differently or by different services, a message broker with multiple queues is ideal. For example, in a social media platform, different queues might be used for handling notifications, message deliveries, and content moderation, all managed by same broker. And when should we use message queue? If we need a simple, reliable way to deliver messages in a specific order, such as in-task queues or job processing. Our system needs to distribute tasks across multiple workers or services in a straightforward manner. Also, if we are implementing asynchronous processing where tasks can be queued and processed independently of their production. So when primary concern is ensuring that tasks are processed in the exact order they arrive without needing complex routing or transformations, a single message queue is the best way to go. In a content moderation system, a message queue might ensure that flagged content is reviewed in the order it was reported, ensuring a fair and consistent moderation process. This was an example of message queue. Okay. So, if we talk about the conclusion or summary, so in summary, both message brokers and message queues are very important tools in distributed systems, but they serve different purposes. Message brokers are powerful and flexible, capable of handling complex communication patterns, while message queues offer a simpler, more direct approach to managing asynchronous tasks. So, this was all that I wanted to talk about, message brokers and message queues. So the focus of this video was primarily on message broker and how it is different from message queues. So I did not talk a lot about message queues because I have made another video on that. So if you have not watched it, please go and watch. And yeah, I hope this gives you a good understanding of message brokers and message queues and how they are different and when they are used. So now when you are making a system in the system design interview, and if you talk about using different services, you can clearly explain if you are going to use a message broker or a message queue. And if your interviewer asks a follow-up question like, why did you choose to use a message broker here instead of a message queue, or a message queue instead of a message broker, you will be in a good position to answer that question. Okay. So yeah, that's all. Thank you for watching. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. I will see you in the next one.